William Gillette was the aquiline and actual embodiment of Holmes himself. It is too little to say that William Gillette resembled Sherlock Holmes. Sherlock Holmes looks exactly like William Gillette.
You are about to hear a short reenactment of one of the most famed characterizations in the history of the American stage, Mr. William Gillette, in scenes from his own play, Sherlock Holmes. The curtain rises on Sherlock Holmes' room in Baker Street. The page boy has just ushered in Dr. Watson, and Holmes, who has been smoking his pipe in the red glow of the hearth fire, rises to greet him.
Ah, Watson, my dear fellow, how are you, Holmes? I'm delighted to see you, perfectly delighted, upon my word I am, but... Oh, I'm so sorry to observe it left you in this way.
She has gone on a little visit, but how did you know?
Well, I like that. How did I know? How do I know anything? How do I know that you opened an office and resumed the practice of medicine without telling me a word about it? How do I know you've been getting yourself very wet lately, that you have an extremely careless servant girl, and that you've moved your dressing table to the other side of your room?
Oh, Holmes, if you'd lived a few centuries ago, they'd have burned you alive.
Such a conflagration would have saved me a great deal of trouble and expense.
Tell me now, how did you know all that?
Too simple to talk about. Scratches and clumsy cuts, my dear fellow, on the inner side of your shoe there, just where the firelight strikes it. Scratches, cuts. Somebody scraped away crusted mud and did it badly, badly. Scraped the shoe along with it. There's your wet feet and your careless servant all on one shoe. Face badly shaved on right side. All that used to be on left. Light must come from the other side. Couldn't very well move your window. Must have moved your dressing table.
Yes, but my medical practice, I don't see
now, how... Now, Watson, how perfectly absurd of you. Absurd to come stamping in here, fairly reeking with the odor of the iodoform, and with the black mark of nitrate of silver on the forefinger of your right hand, and ask me how I know.
Oh, of course, but how the deuce did you know? My wife was away.
Where the deuce is your second waistcoat button, and what the deuce is yesterday's boot on your doing in today's lapel, and why the deuce do you wear the expression of a boiled alligator?
Marvelous, Martin.
Elementary, my dear fellow, elementary. The child's play of deduction. I'm only doing it for your amusement, you know. Sometimes we apply these principles to more serious matters, but then we have to be a little more careful with our guessing or we get into trouble. Sometimes we get into trouble anyway. Watson, my dear fellow, to change the subject a trifle, in the enthusiasm which has prompted you to chronicle, and if you will excuse my saying so, to somewhat embellish a few of my little adventures, you have occasionally seen fit to introduce a certain element of romance, which struck me as being just a trifle out of place. Something like looking an elopement into the fifth proposition of Euclid. I merely refer to this in case you should see fit at some future time to chronicle the most important and far-reaching pieces of work in my entire career. The case of Professor Robert Moriarty.
Moriarty? I don't remember ever having heard of that fellow.
The Napoleon of crime. The Napoleon. Sitting motionless like an ugly, venomous spider in the center of his web. But that web having 1,000 radiations and the spider knowing every quiver of every one of them. And within 48 hours, we'll have the lines drawn so tightly around him that he can't move. We'll arrest him and his entire gang.
My Holmes, this is a very dangerous thing.
My dear fellow, it's perfectly delightful. My whole life is spent in a series of frantic endeavors to escape from the dreary commonplaces of existence. For a brief period, I escape. You should congratulate me.
But you could escape without such serious risks. your other cases have not been so dangerous, and they were even more interesting. Now, the one you spoke of the last time I saw you, the recovery of those damaging letters and gifts from a young girl who, most peculiar affair, as I remember it, you were going to try the experiment of making her betray their hiding place by an alarm of fire in her own house, and after that...
Precisely, yes, after that...
Didn't the plan succeed?
Yes, it succeeded as far as I've gone.
You got Foreman into the house as butler?
Yes, Foreman was in as butler.
And upon your signal, he overturned the lamp in the kitchen, scattering the smoke balls, and gave an alarm of fire. And the young lady, did she?
Yes, she did, Watson. She did. The young lady did. It all transpired precisely as I'd planned. She betrayed the hiding place in her fright, and I took the packet of papers and handed it back to Miss Faulkner.
But why did you hand it back after going to all that trouble to get it?
For the very simple reason, my dear Watson, that it would have been theft for me to keep it. Theft. The contents of the packet are the absolute property of the young lady. My only chance is to induce her to give it to me of her own free will. Its return to her after I laid hands on it was the first move in this direction. The second will depend on what transpires today.
Mm-hmm. Very interesting. Look here, Holmes. You've been so kind as to give me a halfway look into this strange case, but I would certainly like to know what you propose to do with that counterfeit package, which you are going to risk your life to obtain.
I intend, with the aid of the counterfeit, to make her willingly hand me the genuine. I shall accomplish this by a piece of trickery and deceit of which I'm heartily ashamed, and which I never would have undertaken if I'd known her as I do now. That's too bad. Too bad, Watson. She's rather a nice girl, Watson.